Please. Pay this bill.
Congratulations.
Good morning, Mr. President and your Excellencies. May it please this court, this is from Agent SMCI 12, appearing on behalf of the applicants in the advisory opinion on extent of state responsibility to offset timing and defects and applicability of the corporate immunity. May it please this court, this is Agent SMCI 12, appearing on behalf of the applicants in the advisory opinion on the extent of state responsibility to offset the climate change impacts and the case of applicability of diplomatic immunity between the Republic of Moldova and Republic of Hindustan, and also the case of responsibility of Hindustan towards climate change refugees in the case concerning Kingdom of Himalayan State versus the Republic of Hindustan. Your Excellencies, as per para 55 of the Moot proposition, the two specific issues before the Honourable Court at this point of time are with respect to the jurisdiction of the ICJ on the reference as made by the United Nations Security Council to render advisory opinion, and secondly, the extent and applicability of the diplomatic immunity between Moldova and Hindustan. Your Excellencies, for the next 17 minutes of the court, this agent shall assist the court with respect to the first issue, and thereafter, over the next 16 minutes of the court, my co-agent shall assist the court with respect to the issue on diplomatic immunity. If your Excellencies are well versed with the facts of the case, the agent seeks permission to proceed to the arguments. Much of that, Your Excellencies. Your Excellencies, the broader issue on advisory opinion, that the first issue has been divided into three parts. Firstly, that the advisory opinion can be given. Secondly, that the matters can be clubbed. And thirdly, that the liability of Hindustan is there. Your Excellencies, if I come to the first point, that is advisory opinion on the request as made by the United Nations Security Council can be rendered by this Honorable International Court of Justice. It is further divided into three parts. Your Excellencies, the first is that the United Nations Security Council is authorized to seek an advisory opinion. Secondly, it is within its competence to seek an advisory opinion. And thirdly, there are no compelling reasons for the court to decline an advisory opinion. Your Excellencies.
Yes. Whether advisory opinion of ICJ is binding on the Security Council?
Much obliged, Your Excellencies. Your Excellencies, the advisory opinion of the International Court of Justice is not binding on the states or the order requesting it. Thank you for your question. Your Excellencies, in the case of nuclear weapons advisory opinion of 1996, the International Court of Justice held that on the question of whether it has jurisdiction to give an advisory opinion or not, it's to be divided into three components. Specifically, the International Court of Justice looks at one, if you are excessive, may refer to page 17 of the written submission. Firstly, whether the body is authorized to request an advisory opinion. Secondly, whether the issue at hand is within the competence of the requesting body. And thirdly, whether the question is a legal one. Your Excellencies, with respect to the authorization of the United Nations Security Council, the bare text of Article 65 of the Statute of International Court of Justice and Article 96 of the United Nations Charter makes it abundantly clear that United Nations Security Council can request the International Court of Justice to render an advisory opinion on any legal question.
Please, this climate change, please prove whether it is included in the climate change is the legal issue.
Much of that, Your Excellencies. Your Excellencies, that will be my submission when I say that the question is a legal question. And if Your Excellencies want an answer at this point of time, yes, it is a legal question. The question before the Honorable International Court of Justice is the extent of state responsibility. Your Excellencies, there are a number of declarations and conventions like UNFCCC, Tokyo Protocol, and many other declarations which talk about the precautionary principle and the principle of common but differentiated responsibility of the states. Therefore, it is a legal principle as established in the International Environmental Law Framework. And now the question is before the International Court of Justice as to determine the extent of state responsibility of all the states to offset the impacts of the climate change.
Well, can you justify how this climate change issue becomes legal issue?
Much of Your Excellencies, in 2007 and in many other instances, the United Nations General Assembly as well as the United Nations Security Council have adopted resolutions which say that climate change has impacts on peace and security, international peace and security, and therefore the responsibility of the United Nations Security Council is primarily to maintain it, is for the maintenance of international peace and security. Since there is a connection between the impacts of the climate change and the to peace and security, therefore it becomes a legal question in the present framework.
Now, probably you are confusing because of legal issue, it becomes when it is addressed by law. Is there any convention, government or protocol or anything that you can refer by which climate change will become a legal issue?
Much obliged.
Any United Nations Charter is included.
Much obliged.
Some reflection are given.
Whether that particular convention is legally binding or not?
Much obliged. Your Excellencies, the convention, UNFCCC, and many other, the protocol to it as the Tokyo Protocol, though they are not binding on the states unless and until they themselves willingly accept the jurisdiction of the, they themselves willingly accept bindingness of that protocol or the UNFCCC. However, UNFCCC and subsequent protocols make it abundantly clear that climate change issue is a legal issue, Your Excellencies. Your Excellencies, having established the authorization of the United Nations Security Council to seek an advisory opinion from the International Court of Justice, I now move on to show that it is within the competence of the United Nations Security Council to seek an advisory opinion from the International Court of Justice. Your Excellencies, as I already mentioned, in 2007 and at many other instances, the United Nations General Assembly as well as the United Nations Security Council have passed resolutions which link climate change impacts to peace and security of the international community. Your Excellencies, the maintenance of peace and security is well within the competence of the United Nations Security Council. Therefore, this also falls within the competence of the United Nations Security Council, and therefore it can ask, request the International Court of Justice to render an advisory opinion. Your Excellencies, moving on to the issue of there are no compelling reasons to decline an advisory opinion. Your Excellencies, in almost all the cases when the International Court of Justice is approached to render an advisory opinion, the court does not decline to render an advisory opinion unless and until there are compelling reasons to do so. Your Excellencies, this point is further divided into three parts. Firstly, that consent of states is irrelevant. Secondly, Your Excellencies, it is a legal question as has been established by the questions. And thirdly, Your Excellencies, there is potential usefulness in rendering such an advisory opinion. Your Excellencies, if I may refer to the point of consent, Your Excellencies, the point of consent is relevant when it comes to contentious cases, Your Excellencies. When the two parties refer a case to the International Court of Justice, there has to be express consent of both the states, or there has to be compulsory jurisdiction under Article 36 of the Charter of the, under Article 36 of the Statute of the International Court of Justice. However, Your Excellencies, the advisory opinion jurisdiction of the International Court of Justice is derived from the Charter itself, and it is deemed to have been given, the consent of states is deemed to have been given when they signed the Charter of the International Court of Justice.
Not the Charter, but the statute of the International Court of Justice. You are confusing with Charter and statute.
I beg your pardon, Your Excellencies. The agent meant that when the states signed the Charter of the United Nations and the Statute of the International Court of Justice, the consent of the states to abide by the jurisdiction of the International Court of Justice is deemed to have been given. In any case, Your Excellencies, if there is no consent of the states, it is irrelevant as has been held by the International Court of Justice in a number of cases. Your Excellencies, if I may now move to the point that there is potential usefulness in rendering such an opinion. Your Excellencies, if you may refer to page 26 of the written submission, Your Excellencies, though it is not compulsory for the International Court of Justice to look at potential usefulness of the advisory opinion, however, the International Court of Justice always looks at this point whether it is expedient to render an advisory opinion or not, though it is not the sole criteria. Your Excellencies, we submit that recourse to the International Court of Justice by way of this advisory opinion by the United Nations Security Council is a legitimate part of efforts to continue to build political support for stronger action against climate change. Your Excellencies, we all of us understand the plight of the low-lying islands. Your Excellencies, they are on the verge of extinction. It is not a matter of their development or anything else, Your Excellencies. The matter is of their existence, the very existence is at stake. and it is time for the International Court of Justice and the international community as a whole to rise to the occasion and render an advisory opinion which may help in further negotiations on the point of climate change and state responsibility.
Let me ask you one question. Climate justice, is it human rights?
I beg your pardon.
Climate justice, is it human rights?
Much of your excellency.
It is human rights, then what generation of rights?
Much of your excellency. Your excellency, in the Nagimarov's case, the International Court of Justice has held that there is an inextricable link between human rights and environment. And a healthy environment is a sine qua non for right to life. Therefore, where there is degrading environment, there is a clear violation of human rights. Therefore, a clear and healthy environment is a part of human rights of the individuals.
What is the difference between human right and natural right?
If your excellency may repeat the question.
What is the difference between human right and natural right?
Much of that, your excellency. Your excellencies, human rights are the basic rights that the person gets as and when he is born. And your excellencies, natural rights can be held to be a subset of the human rights in this regard. If your excellencies are satisfied with this point, there is potential usefulness in rendering such an opinion. The council now seeks permission to proceed to the point that the matters can be clubbed. Your excellencies, the International Court of Justice has exercised its discretion and clubbed the matter. The three matters, one is the advisory opinion, the second is the case between Republic of Moldova and Republic of Hindustan, and third is the case between Kingdom of Himalayan State and the Republic of Hindustan. Your Excellencies, although the Charter of the United Nations or the Statute of the International Court of Justice is silent as to the power of the International Court of Justice to club matters, however, this power is given to the court under the rules of the International Court of Justice. Your Excellencies, under Rule 47 of the Rules of the International Court of Justice, it is clearly mentioned that the court may at any time direct that the proceedings in two or more proceedings or cases be joined. Your Excellencies, the rules do not specify the considerations that the court takes into account. However, when there is a similar matter, the court does join the matters as was done in the case order joining Costa Rica versus Nicaragua and Nicaragua versus Costa Rica as given on page number 29. Your Excellencies, on page number 29, there are ample number of instances where the International Court of Justice has exercised its discretion and ordered the joining of the cases. Your Excellencies, one of the contention of the respondents in this case is that clubbing of the matters would lead to singling out of Hindustan. They argue that when the climate change cannot be attributable to only one state, how can the International Court of Justice render an opinion in a matter which is clubbed with a matter that involves Republic of Hindustan? Your Excellencies, at this point of time, it is very important to mention, as was the answer of the agent to one of the questions of the bench, that advisory opinions are not binding on the parties. Therefore, it is not a judicial determination of the rights or liabilities of Hindustan or any other party. Your Excellency, what the United Nations Security Council is trying to seek from the International Court of Justice is the extent of state responsibility of all the states, Your Excellency, including the developed as well as the developing states, and not just Hindustan. Therefore, Your Excellency, in this case, the rendering of advisory opinion and the clubbing of matter can in no way determine the judicial rights or liabilities of Hindustan, and it cannot affect their rights. Therefore, it does not lead to singling out, and the clubbing of matters is well within the powers of the International Court of Justice. Your Excellencies, if the Excellencies are satisfied with these 2 points, I now move on to the issue of liability of Hindustan. Your Excellencies, the issue of liability of Hindustan concerns the responsibility of Hindustan towards climate change refugees. Your Excellencies, under the international law, every person has a right to seek and enjoy asylum.
Which international law can you refer to? Every person has a right to seek and enjoy asylum.
Your Excellencies, under Article 14, Subclause 2 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and many other subsequent conventions like the ICC, and the Refugee Convention of 1951, every person has a right to seek and enjoy asylum. Your Excellencies?
No, ICCPR, can you refer to the article? ICCPR, the permits right to seek asylum, is it recognized in ICC? Can you refer to the article?
Your Excellency, the Council is not aware of the exact provision, but it does talk about the right of the person to seek asylum.
No, only in which Article 41 talks about the asylum.
Your Excellency, the Council, the agent is unable to assist the court in this regard and apologizes for the same. Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, the Kingdom of Himalayan State, that's the applicants in this case, submit that the persons who fled from Kingdom of Himalayan State into the territory of the Republic of Hindustan are climate change refugees. Your Excellencies, if you may refer to page 32 of the written submissions, generally understood, a refugee is a person forced to flee his home due to persecution, whether on an individual basis or as a part of a mass exodus due to political, religious, military or other problems. Your Excellencies, this word, the phrase other problems is wide enough to include natural disasters.
Why are you referring to this definition?
Your Excellencies, this is the definition taken from the Human Rights Education Associates, which is an offshoot of the United Nations Office of the High Commissioner for Refugees.
Do you know there is a convention on refugees?
Much obliged, Your Excellencies. The agent is aware of Article 1A of the Refugee Convention of 1951, which talks about the definition of the refugee.
You have given the clear provision in the provision. Again, the likeness under the provisions which have been provided under the government.
Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellencies, I see that my time is over. I seek an extension of 2 minutes to answer this question. Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellencies, the respondents in this case are not a party or signatory to the 1951 Refugee Convention. As such, the agents for the applicants do not want to rely on 1951 to say that they have an obligation under that convention. However, Your Excellencies, we seek to make them liable under the general customary international law under which they have each and every obligation to protect the persons which are within their territory. Your Excellencies, that is the only reason why the council, why the agent did not refer to the definition of Article 1A of the refugees. Much obliged, Your Excellencies.
The reason for what you have done, considered the Article 1 of the convention between 1951, for same reason you can even reject that definition that you cited. Because of, if the state is not party to the 1951 convention, then the definition that you given is not compulsory for the state to follow.
Much obliged, Your Excellency. The definition is not compulsory for the respondents to follow in this case. However, this is a definition that is generally accepted and understood in the general international law framework under which they have obligations and not under the Refugee Convention only. Your Excellencies, if I may refer to Article 14, Clause 2, as I referred of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, every person has a right to seek asylum. Your Excellencies, further, under the provisions of UDHR, United Nations Convention on Child Rights, and the Convention Against Torture, and many other conventions like the Convention for Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, the states have taken upon themselves minimum obligations to respect the basic dignity of each and every individual. Your Excellencies, when the person from the Kingdom of Himalayan State, fled from the Kingdom of Himalayan State into the territory of Hindustan, it was the obligation of Hindustan to respect their basic rights, Your Excellency. The basic rights, as has been held by the International Court of Justice in Barcelona traction case, that the basic human rights are erga omnes obligations from which no country can ever derogate, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if I may refer to page number 35 of my written submission, footnote number 94, Your Excellencies, even if there is an assumption that it was a mass influx, Your Excellencies, persons seeking asylum should always receive at least temporary refuge and must be treated on the assumption of being refugees, Your Excellencies. We are saying that even if the persons from Kingdom of Himalayan State do not meet the criteria of the refugee definition, however, even then, the obligation is on the respondent state to assume that they are refugees till the time the determination of the refugee status is finalized. Your Excellency?
You know, they are not refugees, they are asylum seekers. Initially, you cannot say they are refugees. Well, it is for general proposition we say refugee, but you know, refugee is a given status by law. Until and unless the state has not recognized a person as refugee, then he cannot enjoy the refugee. And for this reason, you cannot refer them as refugees. but you can say that asylum
seekers. Much of your excellency
from natural causes.
Much of your excellency. Your excellency, if I may assess the court in this regard, the Human Rights Committee that interprets the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights has opined in its general comment number 14 that the refugee status is merely declaratory in nature. So once a person fulfills the condition, even if it is not declared on him that he is a refugee, he will be considered to be a refugee till the time he is declared to be so. Your excellencies, it is declaratory and not recommendatory. Your excellencies, the council was the agent was trying to say that in case of mass influx, persons are assumed to be refugees. The obligation is on them to give them the rights. Your excellencies, further, under Article 3 of the United Nations Convention on Rights of Child and Article 3, Clause 4 of the SAARC Convention on Regional Arrangements for the Promotion of Child Welfare in South Asia.
What is your prayer, please tell me, because time is over. So you just put your prayer.
Much obliged, Your Excellencies. Your Excellencies, on my issues, the prayer is that the International Court of Justice has jurisdiction to render an advisory opinion, and the International Court of Justice should render an advisory opinion in this case. Secondly, that the matters, as has been clubbed, are very well within the jurisdiction of the court to club the matters. And thirdly, that Hindustan has violated rights of the international. Hindustan has violated rights of the refugees from the Kingdom of Oman. I now request my co-agent to assist the court with respect to the second issue. It was an honor arguing before the honorable.